Welcome to another Blaster Chat, where we talk about everything from blasters to, I don't know, what kind of food we like. Yeah. My name is Brandon.
Yeah, well, and Brian. We're back here in our studio, and we've had a fun time kicking off 2024. Nexus Pro just has launched.
Oh my gosh, so much
Nexus
fun.
Nexus Pro X, let me be respectful. Make sure the X understands it's just for extreme. We've had a really, really fun time hearing everybody in that follows us online give their feedback and their compliments. So we appreciate it. We thank you. And I think,
we see all.
Yeah, we watch everything and we watch too much. We've had a good time here. And what did we do recently? We're just here to kind of kick off a special. This is kind of a special edition podcast.
So. It really is. It really is. So for those of you who are in the hobby, Maryland Mayhem just happened. And for those of you who aren't in the hobby, well, you're going to learn about what just happened. But what we have the luxury of being able to do is, is our first official virtual podcast. So this is the intro, but what you're going to walk into is actually our first official virtual podcast where we get to interview and do a little meet and greet with the winners of the whole shebang, Magic Smoke.
Yeah, Magic Smoke is our guest here, our first guest on the podcast. So we get to meet their team, and it's really interesting to see somebody who has been, a group of people that are friends at heart and have built a kind of a community and a network of hobby-grade products and blasters that include Dart Zone items and other products out there. But it's basically a good stopping point for us to kind of revisit since – it's been about 4 years since Nexus Pro was launched at Walmart, and Nexus Pro X just launched again.
Crazy 4 years.
So over 4 years, we sat there and tried to kind of get an evaluation of where the category is, where the hobby is, and where to go. So
yeah, they were extremely interesting, really, really cool people to get to talk to, and some of them have actually been in the hobby since 2013.
Yeah.
So well before we were even making mass market 14 plus. You know, pro grade
half length dart blasters, whatever you want to call them these days. So, I think you guys should sit back and enjoy. We had a nice conversation, and if you are in the hobby, it's your best chance to see your friends on the podcast. But if you're looking to get into the hobby, it's a good way to kind of hear about their story and maybe something that strikes home with you for you and your friends.
Yeah,
in your neighborhood.
So. Absolutely. We're going to talk about everything from, their favorite products to, the way that they play. We're also going to talk about where they see the hobby going, certain trends that are in the hobby. And also, if you're looking to get into the hobby, we're actually going to talk about steps that you can take to go ahead and get into the hobby in your local area. So,
yeah. And the final part of this, they were very cool. And we think our ambassador, Derek Sykes, who's also on the podcast for setting this up, and hope you guys enjoy. So sit back, get your popcorn, and we'll catch you soon.
Well, welcome, Sweet. Magic Smoke. You are our first official guest on the Blaster Chat podcast. So you have a very, very good honor there for. So everybody, I'll let you introduce yourselves real quick, say hi, and we'll see how things go.
Hey, how's it going, world? My name is Kobe, otherwise call sign Cobalt of Team Magic Smoke and Cobalt Designs.
Hey, everyone. I'm Jesse, Team Captain of Magic Smoke.
I'm Sarah on Magic Smoke.
And I'm Ben from Magic Smoke.
I'm Hank. I'm the coach for Magic Smoke.
And I'm Archer on YouTube. I'm known as Archer the Nerfer, also on Team Magic Smoke. Great to be here.
Awesome.
Awesome.
Well, really, really, really happy to have you guys. I heard you guys won a little something. It looks like maybe you brought maybe a trophy. I don't know.
Oh, I thought that's where the fruit basket goes.
Which one was from this year?
The trophy grows, so like,
yeah. So
it's the stages of evolution. Next year it's gonna be like the size of like the army trophy.
I love it. That's a really good fruit basket, if you ask me.
How many people have drank out of that thing as well, as what I want to know. So
it's got
to
be.
I threatened to put my iced tea in there, but no one would let me.
Oh, okay.
I sipped, so I might be the first.
All right.
I guess picture evidence.
I love it. I want to get to know you guys, or better yet, I'd like for the community to get to know you guys. So, how did you guys meet? How did Magic Smoke form?
So, Magic Smoke started as a group of friends that all like to play Nerf, and we noticed that the club admins wouldn't really let us play on the same team because it was too good. They kept using terms like, yeah, you're throwing off the team balance, the other team's not having fun, that kind of thing. So we figured if they were having to balance us and split us up at club games, maybe we'd be good at, maybe we are just good at this. So we decided to take on the Foam Pro Tour in 2022. So in late 2021, we formed as a team. Magic Smoke has grown to the point where we actually have two teams, Magic Smoke and Mystic Vapor. It's really all one group of friends, but we break it up for tournaments because they won't let 12 of us play at once. As cool as that would be.
That's when big team battle gets implemented. Then it's going to be all over.
That would really be something.
Yeah.
So the team started myself and Evan Gillette, who's not here with us today. He's at college. Basically co-captains Magic Smoke originally. Then when Evan went to college, I'm doing most of the leading. We do want Evan to come back when he gets a chance, when real life gives him a chance to come back and play, though.
I had a question. You know, you guys have been together for how long? I mean, really, I guess since you guys have only been together for 2022, but you guys have been in the nerfing or the hobby community for a long time. So when do you really remember getting into the hobby, and how long ago was that for everybody?
When did you start?
So the earliest date in my current nerfing career, if we want to call it that, was 2018 at the University of Maryland College Park's Nerf Activity Society, where I ended up running that club for basically until COVID happened. And ever since then, I've been bouncing around the tri-state Nerf scene Uno, and ever since I moved down to Maryland, I've been primarily with the Maryland Foam Alliance. Thank you. I forgot what
they changed the acronym. Originally.
They changed
Team Maryland,
and also there's like three main clubs, so I feel like I should be given a little bit of leeway with forgetting which one it was.
Exactly. Ran a Nerf club in college from 2014 to 2018. Saying that out loud makes me feel old, but here we are.
Wait, what year was it?
2014 to 2018.
Okay.
And then I took a couple of years off. I was in the military. They moved me to Mississippi. There was nothing fun going on in Mississippi, really. So took some time away from Nerf. And then I realized I wanted to get back into it. And I'd say, mid-2020 or so, kind of got back into it. So I had a couple of years off. And then I've been here locally in Maryland, so playing with the same clubs that Cobalt has for the most part, also going up to New Jersey.
For me, I started playing Nerf back in 2016 at UMBC's Humans vs. Zombies Club. Then sometime around, 2020, just after COVID, so, 2021, 2022, started playing PvP a little bit more with the Maryland clubs. And then last year's Maryland Mayhem was when I first started playing competitive, seriously. So from there, so since 2016.
Similar to Sarah, I started with HVZ at UMBC around 2018. Then when COVID hit, there was a bit of a break. And then around 2022, I met Jesse at UMBC HVZ UK one evening. And I kept going to Nerf Herders at the time. And you invited me to come along with you guys to FPT in 2022, and I kind of just stuck around since then.
So I started my nerfing career, I guess you could say, in 2019, again with UMBC HVZ. It's kind of where most of us seem to start from. And I liked it, but I had more knack for PvP, so I was with the local hobbies there. And about 6 months ago, I was pulled from reserves of helping Magic Smoke train to leading them in the tournament, making call-outs and such. So, yeah.
And so for me, I really feel old because I think I'm the oldest of the bunch. So I started nerfing in 2013 at my university's HBZ. I also believe this to be true. I think I'm the only non-Marylander of the Maryland team. I run with the United Nerf Ops up here in New Jersey. But
she's anyway, adopted.
I'm adopted.
Honorary Marylander.
I wear that with pride, honestly. So in 2013, I started in college, and then I was coming to graduate, and I heard about Penn State, and then I got involved with their HBZs, and I never really had a break. It kind of just snowballed down the hill, going faster and faster and faster until I found myself at FPT 2022, where I was on Paradox at the time, and I was friendly rivals with Magic Smoke, funny enough. But I remember we'd beat them within the qualifiers, but we didn't advance to first and second. That was the last time that Paradox had competed all together. The sport was coming to advance, and people just wanted to move on and do other things within the sport as it was growing. So in 2023, I was bouncing around between different teams. I never really had a home for the duration of leaving Paradox. And I had an injury, unfortunately, in 2023. And I have to credit me being on Magic Smoke to Jesse, because I remember that whole year he was just, "You should join us. You want to join us?" And I at least three different times I would go, "Oh, I'm on another team," or, "Oh, I'd be playful, like, "Oh, you gotta be faster than that. I'm on doing something else." But then around Ragnaroktoberfest, I wasn't going, but around that time he had asked me, he goes, "Hey, we're putting the team together. There's a spot open. Do you want to come on Magic Smoke?" And eventually I went and I said, "You know what? I come down on a semi-frequent basis anyway. I love coming down to the Maryland Foam Alliance events. I come down almost as frequent as the UNO events up here." And I started coming out. I came out to different practices whenever I could, then training on my own. And it's been wonderful. And I've been having a great time with it since.
Well, that's extremely awesome. Yeah. Here, Brian, I don't want to interrupt you too much.
Oh, no. I was going to say, I'm kind of taking me back. I mean, Dart Zone, I think his first introduction to the market was in 2013, 2014. So that's 10 years. So it goes by fast. And I see that it's nice to see familiar faces at these events. But like one of the things I wanted to kind of just ask before we, get too far is that how many people do you think right now would put the time and energy into it, they found out about this hobby? Because I think that's the one thing that we are seeing a lot of, is that we're trying to educate the audience about this hobby as much as we are about participating in it as well. How much do you guys feel that is, from people coming by, that is so cool, how do I do that? What do you guys feel? Do you guys feel like you guys are personal ambassadors for the sport as much as, someone like ourselves, on the product side?
I mean, it definitely helps. Like, most of us play semi or regularly, if not like twice a week, UMBC's HVZ games, which is on a college campus. And we routinely, like nightly, like we played Mondays and Thursdays, we pretty much every night stop and talk to somebody who's just walking around campus and going, "Hey, I've like heard about Humans versus Zombies," or, "What game are you playing? This looks like a lot of fun." And just events like that, where it's just like we're on a college campus playing our games, having fun, is a great way. And then it, like, other club games, there's routinely new people showing up going, "Wow, this is cool. I want to play more."
People always ask me, like, "What do you do for like a hobby?" And I say, "Oh, I do Nerf." And that's usually a whole discussion I have to have, like, "Oh, well, it's HVZ and I do competitive," and I have to explain what competitive is because it sounds goofy at first, but then they end up thinking it's one of the coolest things ever and it's so much fun.
Well, it's good to hear, because I think that's the thing that's most exciting about having been myself to these events is how much of a community feel there is about everybody kind of doing, pitching in together to make this opportunity bigger and better. So, I want to say thank you guys.
Yeah, most definitely.
From a company perspective and a brand perspective for how much work you guys are doing. And I hope that, you know, we can find ways to continue to support you along the way. As somebody asked me today, when's the next Dart Zone Pro tournament going to be? And I said, you know, it's on the agenda, but it's, you know, one of those things about is we want it to be bigger and better. And we want bigger opportunities for it to be more teams. And it's just going to take some time to be able to get to that level. So,
yeah. Well, I'd like to kind of piggyback off of that a little bit, because obviously, yeah, I mean, the thing is that we've been watching the community in awe, the things that you guys have built. I mean, it really just takes a love for the sport to be able to build it as large as it already is. But what I would kind of like to know is from 2013 to now, kind of what have you seen change in the landscape of the hobby? And where do you guys think that it's going? I know we've obviously got, you know, we've got HVZ, we've got the competitive stuff, but do you feel like maybe it's more or less HVZ, it's more or less competitive? Do you see some other trends kind of bubbling up? I'd really like to know just what you guys are seeing out there on the actual field, especially since, to echo what Brian's saying, we're all just trying to make this thing bigger and get the word out.
I would say one of the biggest trends and changes in the landscape that has occurred in the last in the last 10 years or so has been the rise of different blaster technologies and trends. Because back in like 2013 or whatever, the pinnacle of technology was probably like the Strife or other like magazine fed flywheelers at the time. And in the year, like within the last like 5 years or so, everyone started shifting to 3D printing and started making their own designs or picking up like community made designs as opposed to just modding first party hardware. And I would say, that new trend of everyone's trying to get more power and more capabilities out of their blasters, like that has kind of led the first parties to sort of react and start feeding into that with now we have first party competitive level hardware, and and that is helping foster a new like as opposed to everyone trying to target like 130 FPS, which was when I got into the hobby, that was like
that was
the
high end at that time. Yeah.
Yeah. When I was getting into when I got into the hobby, 130 was like the 130, 140 was like where you want to be. Cause that was like where pretty much every major event was going to
half dark retaliator kits and stuff like that.
Beefed up strifes, etc. Everything was going to 130, 140. Now it's like, everyone is like trying to, and honestly breaching 200 and like all
there is 300
at this point. So like, yeah. And also now we have a sort of resurgence or not a resurgence, but like some technologies that were originally out of reach for some people are now coming back or are now coming, finding new life. For example, brushless like technology, it used to be found in like maybe one or two community designs, but now pretty much everyone and their best buddy now has a brushless blaster of some kind. We're guilty of that. I think everyone on this team has some kind of brushless thing in their arsenal at this point.
Yes.
And some of us are working on it. So like we're guilty of that. But like not just like brushless technology, but like other new engineering like
half darts.
Yeah,
half darts. That didn't used to be.
I didn't even mention that. Yeah. You're right. Half darts.
I remember cutting my darts, man.
Yeah.
I don't think
any of you cut your darts.
We used to have to make them ourselves, but now you know companies like Dart Zone and Worker and others are producing half darts at scale that are pretty.
And now they're not even just half darts. Now they're different weights, different types, whole nine yards.
I don't think anyone like, except maybe entry level people. I don't know if anyone in the Nerf community really like targets using like full-length darts anymore.
Not
like
competitive flavor.
Not competitive.
Even like HVZ, like even at like Maryland Mayhem, like or like HVZ events, like there's becoming less and less prominent full-length darts. Like, yes, that's probably the most, like, likely place you'll see them nowadays, but they're even less prominent than they used to.
I think the biggest thing, it's like a Nerf arms race of sorts.
Yeah.
More fun. Yeah. You got all the new stuff that are being designer-built, you know, local products that come out into the market, and, you know, you'll get some solenoid brushless motor that hits, like, 250, and you're like, oh, geez. But then it turns into, then again, you get companies like Dart Zone that are coming out with blasters that you could just buy out of the box that just blow the stuff from Nerf, you know, circa 2014 or whatever, just out of the water.
You said it. We didn't say it.
To bounce off of that, I remember when the Nexus came out, and that was just an absolute game changer in our hobby, because the big thing that I've noticed when it comes to talking about our hobby to the general public and saying, hey, it's not the Nerf you think it is, because it's not, is the visualization of what a blaster that someone can get at the store looks like. It's not this thing where, wow, it's hung up right now. My very first blaster is a Rebel crossbow, which is hung up there. And that thing will hit, like, I ran stock for years. That thing hits like 60 FPS, which is nothing now. But when the Nexus came out and it was hitting 150 FPS out of the box, that's huge, especially for someone who doesn't know anything about modding or how the foundation of our hobby works. That was huge. Cobalt was talking about how with the rise of 3D printing, specifically 3D printed blasters, how that changed the game of our hobby and the different things that we as a community are capable of. But I think to go off of that, because I am part of the small bunch that went to Nation versus Zombies in 2016, Nation versus Zombies was essentially a beta event for the End War series now. But I remember going in 2016, my HVZ week-long had gotten shut down. It was my senior year, spring semester, super bummed out. But I remember I went to Penn State and they were advertising NVZ. And the whole pitch to this event was, oh, you have folks from all over the country congregating in Springfield, Missouri, of all places, to play this one massive game of humans versus zombies. And I don't know how we pulled it off. It was an adventure to get there, but I remember going and I remember having that blaster somehow surviving to the end. And it was just this feeling of, I thought it only had stuck around in college campuses and that was that, but it was this feeling of community and that other people felt the same joy that I did too. And I strongly feel that from NVZ, it got people to network and it got people to continue and have those conversations so that when NVZ was over, the next question was, how can we have more events like this? How can we grow into a bigger and stronger event? From that, it created NWAR, it created, I'll just throw out some events, PA Survival Fest, APOC got significantly bigger, Merriman Mayhem. It just created all of these events, and now the community just continues to grow from it, and I think that's really cool. When you mash those two things together, the possibilities are endless, so I don't know. I've been doing this for over a decade, so seeing that to stuff that's higher than that, I have two FDLs over here, is pretty wild.
Well, I think everything that's been done to, so far for my set has been best rewarded or best received through organic opportunities. Like, basically, nothing. This is a people-led, blaster technology-driven kind of, you know, community. So it's the technology that is improving, and that's what our job is to do, is to continue to improve and raise expectations of what you're going to get from a product that you buy at Walmart. And then on top of that, you add in the layers of the people who are the users are the people that are also driving the energy the most and to get new players and grow. So I think you're right. It has to be done, you know, with a collaboration. And I feel that's what we're trying to do here. with Dart Zone. Started the podcast last year. It was like, how do we speak to our audience in a more effective way? So we're always going to be modifying and being more creative about it. So, you know, I think, you know, kind of the transition into is your introduction in Maryland Mayhem was basically the same week as the Nexus Pro and Neon Pro X hit the store shelves. So what was your first reaction when that item came out? I'd love to hear you guys kind of go into that a little bit more.
I can talk as someone on the receiving end of the Nexus Pro X.
That's definitely what I want to hear. Yeah.
Our first round against Uno Reverse, we go and we're working together. Jesse and I are tag team, and we're taking on the right side. We have two guys coming in on the Dorito, and I take out Elvin. Jesse and I together, we go and take out Darshan. And all of a sudden, it is just a call out to me on that darn snake. I get hit from the side, and I'm like, okay. I go and I walk off, and it was a Nexus Pro X. One of our Uno guys had just bought one, like, because he wanted that blaster for the event. And I walk off and I'm like, are you kidding me? There was this huge gap in the snake and he got me right there. And I was like,
Was that Seth?
Okay. It was Seth. No.
Okay. Darshan, I've got the camera actually.
Yeah. If you notice, we get Darshan and then there's a couple beats and then I walk off. It's because Seth got me in that gap.
Through the gap. Okay. I was wondering about that. Yeah. Because then I ended up having a 1v1 from, because we were the last players on there. And I got him out, but you can, if you watch my video, Flankmaster on YouTube, you can see in that round, I tuck back into my cover cause I kind of smell him aiming at me then you can see the dart on camera, like zip right by where I was. It was pretty accurate. I did get him out. I have a lot of practice, in 1v1s, his blaster definitely did not let him down at that point. He had a pretty good, I think he had a, I felt threatened in that 1v1, which is unusual, I would say. A lot of players don't put darts close enough to me to worry me in most situations, but that worked pretty well.
It was coincidence, but I feel that the team energy with you in that moment was pretty strong, because it was like all four of us are there. We're all just like, you can do it, buddy. You got this. And you were like,
it's two the shot. We're just like, that's our
like, let's go. Come on, breathe.
What could you tell if you could tell? Could you tell if the B car was being used in play, or was it just using any other parts? I was just curious to see.
I don't remember what parts he had on it. I will say the inclusion of both the B car and the injection molded centering device are pretty solid on that. I think that's one thing that differentiates the Nexus Pro X versus the previous versions. I would almost say it's worth getting it just for those muzzle attachments. I purchased them separately to do some experimenting with, but
yeah,
they're pretty solid. I think that's the first. It's definitely the first American company to make a B car as far as I'm tracking. So that's cool to see, because they basically can provide some stability with a lot less friction. So you don't lose, you don't lose power, out of your dart while trying to center it. Having been on the receiving end, it seemed accurate enough. He put one right next to my cover. If I hadn't tucked in, I'd be out.
Well, man, that's, look. That's awesome to hear. And I really like all of the context you guys have been giving. I think that as a fellow fan, even outside of us making product, I think it's really, really cool to kind of hear kind of how much things have changed. I did want to know what your favorite game style is. I'm sure that has all kinds of different variables.
Flag dash, you're off the team.
okay, goodbye. It's been fun.
I love flag dash. I think it really allows you to balance teamwork and both aggressive and defensive play. You need to find the right balance. You know, you saw teams this last year that had really, really good aggression. And then there would be a couple matches where it just falls apart for them because they're overly aggressive and things don't work out. And then you've also seen teams that are just too defensive and they're not scoring enough points. I think our team strikes a really good balance of that. We work together really well. We communicate really well. Hank's callouts were really good. I could hear him all the way across the field. All of that meshes in a flag dash match.
All right, good.
you also need all five players in Flag Dash. I feel like you can't get away with just like one star player kind of saving the day. You know, Sarah had a lot of really impressive flank and rushes. But without, you know, the other teammates watching the sides that she's leaving exposed and covering her during those moves, she'll end up wasting that aggressive energy and it won't get her anywhere. Whereas some other game modes you can win by basically one person just kind of gets lucky and does one aggressive thing and it wins the whole game. It's not really as possible in Flag Dash. That's why I enjoy it.
Yeah, there's plenty of games like when we were watching from the sidelines and watching the footage back afterwards. There's plenty of people who like went for these flanks or got flanked, and I think there's a big difference between being able to play aggressive and being able to play aggressive with teamwork. Like, yeah. I spent most of the day, like, if makes I sense. Was like fighting from like the front position, like I know when I was playing snake side, Ben was always one step, one cover back into my right, watching my right. I never looked right the entire day, and I never got shot from the right when Ben was watching me from the right. So it's things like that where it's just, it allows that like teamwork to be exponential. Like, yeah, sure, in any game, if you work well with your team, it's going to be good. But I think in Flag Dash, the ability to work well as a team and the net launch you even farther, it's just, it clicks everything about like what makes Nerf fun.
Yeah, Brandon, it reminded me of our 2v2 game we had in San Jose where we were just thrown out there to the wolves to figure it out. And the first part of me was just get to the cover and figure it out. So when you're here, you're telling me that you're not looking right all day because you know somebody's got your back. That's next level like skill set there. So
it's a lot of trust.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It definitely speaks volumes about the team that you guys have built. And it's really cool that you're able to join a team, I guess, kind of so late from the inception of it. And for you guys to still have that kind of teamwork. I think it's really cool that you guys have been able to build something like that. I will say
just as a quick point. So when I first started coming for practice, I came around on Thanksgiving. That was like our first practice together. Part of me was a little nervous, and I think about it now because there wasn't really any reason to be. I think I was a bit nervous because these guys see each other so often on a local level. And I remember when Jesse and I were talking, I'm fortunate to have United Nerf Ops up here with casual events, but I also have TNT events as well. Those guys run the competitive clinics up here. Obviously, they come up to us and then, you know, on to them, you know, to Magic Smoke. But I remember being a little nervous because I wanted to get in with the synergy, right? Get in with the communication and how the team presents itself from the inside out. And I remember the first couple matches, I fumbled and I like struggled a bit, but I remember it was just like, okay, we're going to get right back in. Okay, we're going to try this. And I remember Jesse and I were like, well, I'll take front. And I said, and you take back. And I'm like, okay. And we flanked them. And it was awesome. It was such a confidence boost. And then from that point on, the rest of the day, it was just bouncing pairs and, you know, work in the middle. And it just clicked at that point. So it was, I think for me, there was a little bit of a learning curve, but it wasn't anything that I wasn't confident in. It was just a matter of getting up to speed with everybody. And once that happened, it was. I don't think anybody felt like, oh, you're doing this wrong. Oh, you're doing this wrong. It's if we're struggling with something, it's like, okay, I'd watch that gap. Okay, I'll, you know, trade one and twos with you. It's more of a dialogue as opposed to wagging the finger. And I think that's great. It was really cool.
Archer's a really good team player and communicator. And I knew that just based on seeing her in other games. So even though she hasn't been practicing with us as long as some of the other team members, it felt like our communication was still on that high level that we expect from everybody because she focuses on that so much as a player.
Mm-hmm. And then other teams take notice of that too. I mean, you guys can agree to disagree, or I don't know what your thoughts are, but I mean, other teams take notice in how people communicate and then they think, wow, I want to be like that. How can we be like that? And then that motivates more teams to grow and existing teams to get better.
I'd like to harp on that a little bit of you put good in and you get good out with these sorts of teams. I joined in quite late. Jesse messaged me and was like, hey, you want to coach our team? And this is like a few months out. And I'm like, okay. Cause all I've really done has been practicing. But just great vibes all around. You just put in the high energy, positivity, and it just, I feel like that carries the team way more than strategy ever could.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Like, I wouldn't say, like, all of us, like, when we're playing together, when we're practicing, there's not, like, a winning in practicing. There's a getting better in practicing.
Having fun.
Yeah. And having fun while practicing. Like, when we would go to practice and stuff, like, I'm not going to practice to try to, like, stomp everybody into the floor. We're going to do that anyways. I'm going to practice to have fun. So, like, when we're there, I'm like, we're talking, even if, like, Sam and I were on the same team for one of the games, I was watching Sam play, and I'm like, hey, Sam, based off what I saw in this game, I think if you had maybe done X, Y, and Z thing, you might have able to, like, you know, capitalize better in a more scenario that might have been more competitive. And Sam's like, that's really smart. I'm going to keep note of that. So there's this, like, growth of, like, you see one thing and you mention it to a teammate, and it's not like a you did something bad. It's that, hey, based off of my perspective, here's a way we can improve. And I'm going, that's really good. I'm going to file that away. Because something that's easy to forget is just because it worked doesn't mean that it was the best. So all of us working together on our own perspective of what is the best, channeling then forward to something that is the best.
Yeah.
We'll say on the game mode side, we also are hoping to go to Rag in the fall and play some King of the Hill. That's a very different game mode for us. It lasts for 6 minutes instead of two. So we can't win as quickly as we're used to.
Very cardio heavy.
But I think we're going to do very well, because as everybody's been saying, the teamwork and the communication and having fun as a team and watching each other's backs, and then that just forms the core of the strategy. That translates, from what I've heard, pretty well to King of the Hill, because it's all about respawning in a way that covers your teammates' vulnerabilities and just staying aware of the whole field at the whole time, because you get to respawn in that mode. It lasts for longer. I think we're going to do quite well there, because we have a lot of we have a lot of good teamwork.
Well, Justin, there a couple of times you kind of watched some replay. If somebody was watching this podcast for the first time and wanted to like learn about what Maryland Mayhem was, is there a place where it may not be there yet, but is there a place where people can go watch video online and kind of see how the games work for their friends? Because that's the question that I was going to lead to next. Like, what is Maryland Mayhem? Like, how long has it been going? And where do you see it going as an event, so that, next year, if somebody else wanted to join, they can kind of figure, they'll have some guidebook for their planning.
That's a great question. So Maryland Mayhem has been going for 2 years now. We had it in 2023 and 2024. Magic Smoke won both the tournaments of MFT, so we have two trophies. Maybe we'll make it a third next year. I don't know. I will say the other teams have been getting way better, so we're going to have to up our game if we want a third one of those. They did not make it easy.
Singapore was wicked good.
Yeah. Some guys from Singapore came out. They're good competitors. We got folks from Florida, California, New Jersey, New York, Ohio.
UK.
Some folks in the UK. So Maryland Mayhem draws some of the toughest competitive teams for the Maryland Foam Tournament. There's also I think one of the best run Humans versus Zombies Invitationals every year occurs there. I play with UMBC every week at their HBZ games, and UMBC Zombies are some of the smartest people you'll ever have the misfortune of playing against in HBZ games. Playing with them is on hard mode for sure. It makes for a very enjoyable game. And then the 11th hour Blaster Battle and Blaster Convention the next day just caps it off for a really nice 3-day event that's absolutely worth traveling for. So I really like how MFT packages all three of those things into one event. You asked about footage, Brian. I think I've got a YouTube channel. I go by Flankmaster. That's the nickname Andrew gave me. I guess it's a play on Flankmaster Flex or Funkmaster Flex, who was a rapper. I don't know. I was homeschooled. That's lost on me. Stuck around. I know Cobalt's got a YouTube channel, Cobalt Designs. Archer's got a YouTube channel, Archer the Nerfer.
I think there's at least like a dozen people who have posted their footage of MFT online.
Yeah, I know Team Orca did. Yeah, if you just search for like Maryland Foam Tournament 2022, 2023, you'll find good head cam from individual players.
And then there's the event.
Horizon has a recap.
They have a big live
stream. Yeah, the event had a live stream they were running that had four camera angles going.
That's pretty
so you can watch back. I think it's like 7 hours long. You can skip through the matches because people have timestamped them down below and just see like all the different clips of like watching. Here's how the game runs. Here's the general flow of things. Here's what to see and expect. And then dial it in from there and find people's individual footage to like get that like first person view of it.
I will say two things on the footage. One, Magic Smoke and other competitive teams absolutely rewatch that footage to try to learn from it. Both stuff that other teams did well and did poorly that we can learn from or avoid. And then also looking at our own play, you know, there's sometimes I look at that and go, wow, I just got lucky there. I did that wrong and it kind of worked out, but I need to fix that for next time. Or, yep, that's why I got out. You know, I didn't see this other thing that was happening. That's really informative. The other thing is as you're watching this footage, you know, we have the pretty jerseys, you know, we the blasters look cool. The field looks really well set up. I think from a lot of the new players that are that I interact with that are interested in competitive, that can look kind of intimidating. But I want to emphasize nobody's that good in this hobby. Seriously. Like if you compare us to like pro paintball, Speedsoft, like nobody's really there yet. You know, all of us are hobbyists at the end of the day. This isn't my job. I have a real job. This isn't, you know, I'm not in the gym every day training for this. Sarah did make me work out a few times on the way leading up to this. You know, we were doing leg day and stuff, but that definitely helps. But you know, I don't have like a personal trainer who's like giving me a diet and all this stuff that like pro athletes have to do this. So it is accessible, absolutely, for people who are just like watching it for the first time. You know, they might not worry they can play at that level. If you spend some hobby level time on weekends, you know, at home, at events, just preparing, you definitely have a good shot. So don't let that intimidate you.
Yeah, like I got started playing competitive with a 120 FPS blaster against these guys with their like 200 fancy stuffs, and here we are now. So you can like pick up something like that. Even was there weren't even good. Like I wasn't even using something good off the shelf. I was just using off the shelf basic stuff. Like there's way better options now for getting into competitive than there ever was.
Yeah, I think we already talked about Nexus Pro.
Not to go back to the previous
competition. When I first got into the PvP, I had like a Retaliator with a half dart worker kit and like an orange mod work setup.
Nice.
And that was the best I had. It was like 120 at most going to PvP games. Once we got in like the 150s for our local hobby, and it's like, you know, we just make do. You just have fun.
Yeah, and you can, it's, that's the type of stuff you can get started in competitive with. Like, the difference between 150 FPS and 200 FPS is not something that can't be made up for with skill.
So yeah, we
want you to hear.
That's a good point, yeah.
It's not legal now, but I did FPT, like, 2019, and I remember going to teammates and saying, you see that guy with the blowpipe? Yeah, he's a problem. You used to have PVC with the mouthpiece, and people would single shot have the blowpipe because those were illegal, and they'd be shooting shots cross field, and they were scary accurate. So I miss it personally for safety reasons. I get why that's not a thing anymore. But to see where people come from to now is pretty crazy. And I would agree with the intimidation factor because I actually went away recently on a work trip, and I was talking about competitive to one of the electricians that I was working with, and I was trying to help him out and hooking him up with the Kansas City Nerf Club, which was local-ish to the area I was in, if 4 hours is local. But I remember him going and saying, oh, I really want to try it, but I don't know where to start. It looks like it's, you know, a bit too much for me. And so having that dialogue, and I know for me, I've been doing this for a while, but it's still something that I have to practice, and having that dialogue where it doesn't come off as this super aggressive, intimidating thing, because visually it kind of can look that way at first, is something that is just an ever-growing art. But it definitely is possible. Like Sarah said, you can run in with a blaster of 120 FPS. I've seen folks run in with 110, and just from how their playstyle accommodates to that blaster, they're able to make it. So,
but now you don't even have to worry because you can go to Walmart and pick up a Nexus.
Peak slide.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really important note, especially as, yes, we have all seen the FPS counts creep up and up and up and up. I mean, in a previous podcast of our own, we have basically been like, we have met the legal limit of what we can export and import. Like, we cannot go past 200 out of the box. That's why we're having to sell Spring separately. So it's really nice to hear that, like, yeah, no, I mean, you really don't have to go to 300 to be a really good competitive player. And I think that the accessible nature of that is really nice. I mean, I think when I was younger, right, I tried conventional sports and it just didn't really interest me. So it's really like it would have been really, really cool when I was a whole lot younger to have had this, like, really young, right? Like, I mean, this I like the idea of being able to be like, I don't know, 10 and be like, you know what, sounds fun. But this wasn't something that I had access to at the time. So I think that's really, really cool to see. Well, I have a couple other questions. The next one is, let's assume we have people that have just bought something off the shelf, maybe a Nexus, maybe an Aeon, but they've bought something off the shelf and they're like, I'd really like to play competitively. For those that are new to the hobby and have just stumbled into this podcast and are getting to know all of us, what is the best place for them to find a local club?
Unfortunately, Facebook. I personally dislike Facebook as a platform, but every time I talk to a new person at the club, hey, how'd you find out about us? It's always Facebook. So there are a lot of local pages, and that can be an easy way to find a club. Honestly, Google could be a good start. And even exploring the local college might help you find a Humans versus Zombies club near you. A lot of those players probably also play other foam sports, like perhaps a higher FPS competitive game. So that would be a way to start.
Hopping on one of the big Nerf Discords also as well. There's like a decent number of Nerf Discords that are pretty large out there. Hopping on there and being like, hey, this is the region I'm in. Do any of you guys know of any clubs around here?
And pretty much every major city's got something.
Yeah, like, that's pretty, like, we're East Coast, so I don't know. I know sprinklings about other places, but if you were like, hey, I live here, there's going to be someone from close enough to that region or someone who knows enough about that region to be like, check this out, or here's an invite to my server where we play and talk about stuff. So it's just one of those of Discord, Facebook, Google, colleges.
And like, once you find one person,
you find
one
more.
You find the rest of them. We all network really well.
Like, yeah, you find one, you find the next, and then there's like, I've joined one Discord. Here's five other clubs all present in this Discord, all who have their own Discords, who all have, you know, a bunch of other clubs that they interact with.
I don't even remember how I started coming to Maryland, but I just remember, like, once I came to one, I just started showing up to the rest of them.
I mean, the biggest thing, we're all really nerdy, and we're all really passionate about the hobby. So we will...
Yeah.
Your ear off about it.
Well, I think that's one of the things that we've been trying to do with our website with DarkZoneBlasters.com is to kind of start an opportunity for people to post about their clubs, about their upcoming games, community. You know, because we do think that the more people are able to come out and find a game quickly. And get into it as soon as possible, instead of it being much more of a, either you fall into it or you find a friend from a referral. So that's one thing we're trying to do. So I don't think it's fully fleshed out where we want it to be on the site, but that's something we're going to be still putting energy and resources into. So that's the only thing I think we can kind of we'll continue to offer and share out when that's up in a more official capacity. Is that correct, Brandon? It's still in its infancy about how easy it is to use.
Yes, that is definitely something that we're working toward. Ultimately, we have continued to say it over and over and over again, but we are advocates for the hobby and for growing the hobby, and we want to get more people to it. So that is something that we were wanting to do, is give a place for the community to drop their events in. Not as a way to step in and say, this is the place to drop your stuff into, but more an opportunity to kind of try to provide a place for people to quickly find that if they happen to be on our site. I guess speaking of, our site, and this is a terrible segue, but the thing that I really want to know is I want to know you guys' opinion on Bamboo 22Xs. I know that sounds like a plug, but a little birdie has let me know that you guys played exclusively with those and then won the whole shebang. So why did you choose them, and what did it feel like to win?
So they're all looking at me.
You're the one who weighed every single dart that he buys.
Yes. So so most if you look at the footage, a lot of our team is running flywheel of blasters, which are not terribly picky about the dart choice. But I used a Springer. It's a 3D printed design called the Lynx, made by Orion Blasters. It's a I really like the design because it's compact. It's a bullpup form factor, which for competitive, I think is very important, because if your barrel sticks too long around the corner, somebody can see that's the way that you're facing, and then they know they can run at you from the other side, or they know to duck because they saw your barrel coming. So that compact form factor in a Springer is important to me, and it's very tunable. So one of my favorite aspects of this hobby is the ability to tinker with things. And modify them. That's why, I was happy when I saw the Mark III came with that little XT60 connector inside. It was obviously designed with that moddability in mind. It was like, wow, this company has like noticed us, right? So any blaster I can tinker with is a good thing. We used to use a lot of Worker darts, which is a company in China that makes a pretty decent dart. But unfortunately, in the months leading up to the tournament, we noticed that the quality control of those, for whatever reason, has just dropped off completely. And I can prove this, actually, because I have a bag of leftovers from last year. So in 2023, we ran those. And then comparing this year's darts to last year's, they are all, on average, a smaller diameter. And for a Springer player like me, that means I need basically a different barrel. I got a tighter barrel for my Lynx. It's a 0.501 inch internal diameter instead of 0.509. So only 8/1000ths of an inch tighter, but it does make a difference. And even that wasn't enough to reliably make the Worker darts be consistent. So that's when I started looking at the Bamboos. I had played with the first generation of Bamboo darts, but the 0.75 gram weight was very light. The 0.85 grams of the Bamboo 2Xs is a little bit of extra power. I know I've bugged Derek about this before. If it was at all possible with the lawyer's blessing to make a heavier version of the Bamboo, I would buy the entire stock there. That would be.
Well, don't worry, buddy.
Because basically, the heavier dart will slow down less.
Don't worry. I passed that information along. That's all I'll say.
Yeah. All right. Spoilers.
So he has passed it along.
So when I'm tuning my Springer, I will modify exactly how much air is in the plunger tube, exactly how tight the barrel is, exactly how long the barrel is, and whatever scar or any other device I'm using on the muzzle for spin stabilization. I match all of those things together. And I can't do that when the darts are different thicknesses from each other, because it'll work with some of them, and then I'll go into a match and I'll have some of, you know, what I think is the same dart, but they're all inconsistent, and then I'm getting it can be, as I was observing, as bad as like a 30 FPS difference from shot to shot. So if I'm aiming up a certain amount to try to hit somebody's half their forehead that's out of cover, and you know, my last shot I know it dropped a certain amount, I aim that same certain amount and the next dart goes too fast or not fast enough, I miss it. You know, ranges in competitive play, you can easily miss by like a foot or two. It's not even close.
For a perfectly tuned blaster too.
Yeah. You got to have darts that are consistent.
You're getting 50, 60, 70 FPS drops sometimes. Yeah. It won't even come out the barrel.
Yeah. So that's why I really enjoyed the Bamboo 2X darts, because what the Bamboo darts do that others don't is they squeeze the dart after the foam has been extruded. So when they're making the dart, they squirt some foam out of a tube basically and try to make it about the right size. That process is inherently going to be not perfect. I mean, we're talking like thousands of an inch difference, right? Mm-hmm. So then they take the extra step of squishing them with basically some hot metal, as I understand it. And that piece of metal is always the same size from dart to dart to dart. So the darts themselves, I test the fit of a lot of the darts that I use, at least a few from each batch, to see how they feel in the barrel. And there is some variance in the bamboos, but it's a lot less than other darts I've played with. So that's why I use them. If you can see the footage from MFT, I'm making shots on, half of people's head cover to cover, yep. Half of their arm, an elbow, that kind of thing. And you just can't get that kind of precision if your darts are all over the place.
Well, that's a great, you actually hit it right on the, you hit the science, right? The nail right on top of the head there. So it's the bamboo darts are two process separations. You extrude the darts and then you heat press them, which basically molds them into a standard size and scale. But also with the, if we don't have one on the screen, but we'll show it, we'll pull one out and show one. They are pressed with ridges that allow, you almost get a perfect air seal. And that perfect air seal then allows you to maximize your performance on top of being reliable and consistent. So it's just like anything else that you, people who are passionate can tell the difference. And we know that you're the proof of that. You guys have,
I could talk,
you tested everything, yeah, and you're winning. So, credit to you guys.
Well, I don't know that I got an answer about the last question, which was, how did it feel to win?
It was fantastic. I mean, I think, we were all hugging and jumping around and freaking out. And what was really nice about it was, it wasn't just like, yeah, we won, y'all are going down or whatever. It was, everybody was, even people on other teams were excited for us. Had we lost to Nebula in that final match, we would have been excited for them. Especially when it got towards the finals in that tournament, it's teams that we know and we like. We like these people. Our relationship with them matters more than our status in like one tournament or another, or how a particular game comes out. So we're there to experience and see good gameplay and have a good time. So that victory was really sweet, and it was a lot better because the community is there for us as well.
It also made the injuries worth it.
Yes, Cobalt was dealing with a massive leg cramp. We basically handed them a whole bunch of ammo and said, just hang out in that back piece of cover.
I moved it down. My role changed from berserker mode to rear line guard, essentially, in the span of like two rounds.
Drink some salt if you're going to be running all day. Drink some Gatorade and stretch.
Pickle juice, yeah. Pickle juice will help you there, so.
But, yeah, all of the pain was forgotten for a few minutes. My feet hurt later in the day, but it was totally gone. We dumped a bunch of darts on Hank. instead of Gatorade,
that was good. YQ and I walked off. YQ was playing with Nebula International. I remember it was interesting. So he fell and I like felt things at the same time, tagged him, everything just happened. And I was just like, okay. And so like, I put my hand up and he's just like smiles just on the ground. And I'm like, all right, buddy, let's get up. All right, we traded, let's go. And then that's when things just got absolutely wild. And then I remember like Piggy's is running. Ben does this absolutely epic save, Ben and Sarah. And the three of us stop. Because you go to walk off, everybody's losing their mind. We stop, we watch, and it's like, okay. And we go and just the ground is still going. But Nebula like did an absolutely fantastic job. Nebula and Nebula International, as well as Orca Company, everybody who came out and played, winning the tournament was, as I'd mentioned earlier, last year I had gotten injured. So just from doing that and then having just full night and day with a team that I'm very passionate with and going all the way. I've never won first in anything. I've never known the feeling of what that was like. And so having it sit and just realize, oh my God, we did it. We won. We all had this, just this realization of celebrating together with the community was, I don't know. It was a liberating experience for me. So it was a fantastic day. The whole weekend was really incredible. So
Ben, your team got out relatively early in the LM last year, but then this year you made it all the way through. How did that feel?
I felt really, really good. Being as Sam said, one of the people who helped save it with Sarah, of course. But watching Mystic Vapor this year was still really nice. They played really, really well. And knowing that was the team I originally started on, especially last year, was really, really nice to see them play, watch them grow as a team. And again, as Jesse said earlier, we're all one team. So when we see our friends play, it's always good.
It was extra crazy this year, like looking back from the finale game, like the entire like Elim bracket, like the final three matches was Nebula, who came in second last year, Orca Company, who came in third last year and third this year, and then Nebula International, who has people have won tournaments in Singapore on them. So like the final three games of just like the stack of just like Goliath after Goliath after Goliath, just culminating in a 10-9 victory over Nebula International was like, you cannot write like a better story.
Like, yes.
Looking at it going there, like the storyline leading up to it of just like the friends facing friends, beating friends. Like we beat Orca and Orca's like, hell yeah, guys, you go out there and you beat, win this all, because it makes us look good if you win.
They were fantastic.
Yeah. So just like I talk to some of the people we beat like on a daily basis now, because, well, you make good friends when you beat somebody in a tournament. So
Fair point.
Memories, man. It's all about. I think we're all getting together, doing opportunities to make memories. And I appreciate you, taking time today with us to kind of make a new memory here on the Blaster Chat series as well. Because you tell us a little bit about your history, how, where you see the dart hobby going. So before we sign off, anything you want to say, closing words, and we'll let everybody get some dinner. It's getting close to dinner time for everybody. So,
what I will say is, watch out, California, because we're coming. We're not just going
to. Uh oh, first shot.
Let's go.
That's pretty.
All right.
Cool.
Well, guys, this has been awesome. I really appreciate the time, and I mean, hey, I'm hoping that you guys head out to Maryland Mayhem again next year, and maybe we'll have another recap podcast after we win it all again.
We'll see. The other teams are getting tough. They're going to give us a run for our money. I give it for sure.
Oh, man. Well, thank you so much. And for anybody who has any questions, we will leave the comment section open in our YouTube channel. And I would actually like to go ahead and make sure that we get the YouTube channels of the people in this chat today. That way we'll get to throw that into the description. That way you can find them as well. So anyway, signing off for today. My name is Brandon, and we've got a lot of people here.
And Magic Smoke, Derek, we're all here, one big happy family. So till the next time, blast away. Have some fun. We'll see you soon.
Yeah. See you guys.